So we want to say welcome to Fairfax Community Church. We are so delighted that we can gather here today and welcome Spirit's presence in our midst as we join together in spiritual community. So I invite us just to take a deep breath and let it out with an extra long sigh. And just pause for a moment to welcome Spirit with us. Loving Creator, ground of our being, source of all that is, we welcome your presence with us today as we meet, as we gather, as we pray, as we combine our hearts and souls together as one community. Be with us to center ourselves in you, that we may be refreshed for your service. We pray this in your many names. Amen. And if you have a candle handy, we also light our candles together this morning, reminding us that we are in Spirit's presence indeed. As we gather. One community with our lights together. So I invite us to say together the call to worship from John Philip Newell this morning. In the silence of the early morning, your spirit hovers over the brink of the day, and new light pierces the darkness of night. In the silence of the morning, life begins to stir around me, and I listen for the day's first utterances. In earth, sea, and sky, and in the landscape of my own soul, I listen for utterances of your love, O God. I listen for utterances of your love. May we listen together for utterances of God's love as we gather this morning. And so as we gather for our embodied prayer practice, I'm going to remain seated. And I invite us first just to take a deep breath, kind of a fountain breath from the kind of depths of our being up and then around, perhaps with our arms. So to take a deep breath. And then end it out with a sigh, whoo, like it's a fountain around us, a fountain of splashing water, living water. Once again, take a deep breath. And let it out with a sigh, whoo, and imagine that all around us. And as we do that, feel yourself connected to the earth below. Take a deep breath and then feel yourself connected to the sky above. And then let that light surround you as if you're being held in a bubble of light and love. And then feel that around you. You might want to even move your arms a little bit. Like the tranquil waters. What does tranquil water feel like to you? Still water, peaceful water. This is what God guides us to. And you may want to then reverse your breath and take a deep breath and then bring your hands down through you. And feel the cleansing breath, the restoration of the breath. As air and water flow together to create a centeredness in the center of our souls. And just feel that for a moment. the centeredness in your own soul and the depths of your being, in your solar plexus as well as your heart. Know that this is where God dwells, within us, where spirit dwells. These are the waters of restoration that spirit guides us to. And so we honor each other in this walk of sacredness. And I'll invite us then to share together this song. It is one that you may be familiar with. It is often sung in spiritual communities. And this particular version that I found just tweaks the tune slightly. It's still essentially the same tune, but it's just a little bit different. So if you're used to it, I think you'll be able to adapt pretty quickly. But the words are printed in your bulletin, and I invite us to sing along as you feel comfortable, or just notice the words, because there's a real beauty in poetry, as you may know if you're familiar with the song, in the words themselves, about finding the quiet center, which is the place where God calls us in the restoration of our souls. So as you're ready, Gabe, feel free to share the video of that first song.
Come and find the quiet center in this crowded life we lead. Find the room for hope to enter. Find the place where we are free. Clear the chaos and the clutter. Clear our eyes that we may see all the things that really matter. Be at peace and simply be. Silence is a friend who claims us, cools the heat and slows the pace. God it is who speaks and names us, and knows our being, touches base, making space within our thinking, lifting shades to show the sun, raising courage when chaos and the clutter. the things that really matter, be at peace and simply be. Be at peace and simply be.
Such a beautiful song and such beautiful words that remind us of the peace we can find in the company of spirit and together in our spiritual community. And the song reminds us that we also hold each other's needs. We care for each other and pray for each other in community as well. So I invite us now to lift up our prayers for each other, for our wider community, for the world, trusting that spirit is with us as we do so. Let us lift up our prayers of the community together as we gather. Gracious divine being, we also ask your blessing on those who are traveling as part of our community, maybe with Casey and her family as they are in Southern California. Be with Joanne and Jim as they travel across the country. We pray for continued healing for Joanne's heart condition and Jim's throat. May this truly be a time of restoration and renewal and blessing and joy for them. We pray continued healing for Manoush in her path of wellness and for all the needs of our community that we may not even know. We know that you know what is needed, gracious one, and ask that you will provide exactly what is needed for each one. We lift up this prayer. God, in your grace, you hear our prayers. And so, trusting that spirit continues to hear both our spoken and unspoken prayers, I invite us to say together the prayer of Yeshua. Indwelling God, infused throughout all existence, we honor you with many names. Your realm is within the human heart. We accept life for all that it can be, on earth as throughout all creation. May we continue to draw sustenance from this earth, and may we receive forgiveness as we forgive others. May we ever move from separation toward union, to live in grace with love in our hearts, forever and ever. Amen. So would anyone like to sing the Shema this morning? Okay, I can sing it. If someone else, does someone want to read the Mark passage? Thank you. Does someone want to read the Psalm 23 paraphrase? Thank you, Ruth. Okay. I hope I can say it. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Sing with me. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad.
Sacred Text 1, Mark 6, 30 through 34, followed by 45 through 51. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told them all that they had come and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went ashore, Jesus saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. After teaching the crowds and feeding the 5,000, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After saying farewell to them, he went up on the mountain to pray. When evening came, the boat was out to sea, and Jesus was alone on the land. When he saw that the disciples were straining at the oars against the adverse wind, he came towards them early in the morning, walking on the sea. He intended to pass by them, but when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost, and they cried out. For they all saw him, and they were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Be not afraid." Then he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased.
The Lord is my pace setter, paraphrase of Psalm 23 by Toki Miyashiro. The Lord is my pace setter, I shall not rush. She makes me stop and rest for quiet intervals. She provides me with images of stillness, which restore my serenity. She leads me in the ways of efficiency through calmness of mind, and her guidance is peace. Even though I have a great many things to accomplish each day, I will not fret, for her presence is here. Her timelessness, her all importance will keep me in balance. She prepares refreshment and renewal in the midst of my activity by anointing me with oils of tranquility. My cup of joyous energy overflows. Surely harmony and effectiveness shall be the fruits of my hours, for I shall walk in the pace of my God and dwell in her house forever.
Isn't that just a beautiful rendition of the psalm? I absolutely love it. And forgive me here for a moment. I wish I could say that I have mastered that psalm. I have not. As many of you know, and for those who may be watching later, I just moved just this last week and last night, and there are plenty of times when I was rushing. Plenty of times when it felt like we were kind of racing against the clock. So I am still working on trying to master this psalm. However, I will also say that in the midst of all that, there really were moments. One day in particular, I think, moving day when the vans came, when I felt as if I was really uplifted by prayer. I could tell people were praying for me. And for those of you who were, I'm deeply grateful. Because I felt that. I had that sense of there's a lot to do, but I still felt like Spirit was with me and there was a presence and even kind of a calm in the midst of the frantic activity. So I'm certainly not there all the time, but I have tasted that. And I think that is what God invites us to kind of invite Spirit in the boat with us. So that the things we do, even if sometimes they are many things, perhaps we're being invited to do them from a place of centeredness, which of course is the trick, as we know. And I think this gospel also gives us some clues of how to do that. Because I think the ultimate message of both the psalm and this gospel is God actually wants us to feel restored, to feel rested. God doesn't want us to work in such a way that we're just exhausted all the time. We kind of think that that's the badge of glory. But when we really look at Scripture, I don't think Scripture is saying that, because God knows we will be more productive in terms of the fruit of loving kindness if we can also be centered in God, which includes rest, right? So that's the thing I love about this gospel passage. It's kind of a hymn and a gem that we don't always talk about a lot in the various lectionary cycles. But I think there are some real gems in this passage of the gospel. And I just want to highlight a few of the gems. And then I will give us the opportunity through Lectio Divina to really deepen what we're noticing as well. But I want to highlight a few things first. One, we notice this lovely phrase that Jesus utters to the disciples, which is, come away with me. Come away with me and rest a while. Come away and rest a while. And what we notice is that Jesus notices what's going on with the disciples. They're busy. They've been working very hard and they're a little frazzled. And to understand that, we have to pan back and see what happened before this. And earlier in Mark is when Jesus sends them out two by two. He sends them out on this mission of compassion to the greater community. And there they do, I see it as Jesus has been training them and he sends them out on a mission to go and see how's that working? How's all the stuff I taught you working? So they go out and they're healing the sick and they're ministering to people and they're teaching people about God's love and forgiveness for them. And they've just been out for days doing that. And they've just come back and they're reporting to Jesus and telling Jesus everything that's happened. Now, simultaneously, the scene is very busy. A lot of people are coming and going. So we can only imagine that perhaps some of those people have followed the disciples now, not just Jesus. They're following the disciples because the disciples have been doing this work. So Jesus noticed there's a lot of hustle and bustle, and the disciples don't have leisure, it says, even to eat. So Jesus notices, this isn't sustainable. My disciples need some downtime. So he models that for them. He initiates, and that's very important because we usually think as Christians that God, again, just wants us to be working all the time. But it's Jesus that initiates and says they need rest and leisure. Come away to a deserted place for a while. Leave the crowds. Plug back in to God. So they do that. So we notice first Jesus's invitation for them to come away, rest, that is really important for them to be able to continue to do God's work. Second, we notice there's an interlude sandwiched between these two stories. The interlude in Mark is the feeding of the 5,000, which I think is very interesting that in Mark's gospel, all these things are combined. We talked more about the feeding of the 5,000 last week in John's gospel, But I think it's also a statement here that God wants to feed us physically, emotionally, spiritually. Again, Jesus notices their needs, the needs of the crowd, to also physically eat, to be nourished. So all of this is in the context of nourishment, I think, for our bodies and souls and spirits. And then we have this lovely story of the disciples and the boat and Jesus. And I think a big part of this story is exactly what Cindy highlighted for us last week, that sometimes we have to invite spirit into the boat with us. We have to be intentional about that. And so we notice that, again, Jesus has first sent the disciples away so they can have some time to themselves. Then they end up on the water in a boat. And again, Jesus notices. We notice that Jesus notices what they need. They're straining against the oars, against the wind. They're struggling to get to where they're going. So Jesus puts himself in closer proximity to them, but then he acts as if he's going to pass them by. And that's an important part of the story. And some people think, well, is Jesus just being aloof? Is he just playing hard to get? Is he testing them? I don't think it's any of those things. We notice that Jesus does things slightly differently in each situation according to what's needed in the situation. We think about John 20, after the resurrection, when the disciples are literally locked in a room out of fear, Jesus just appears. He literally comes right through the locked doors and just appears in their midst and gives them peace. So I think it depends on the situation in terms of what is needed. Jesus is clearly accessible. He's the one that's noticed their need. But I think he doesn't want to impose. When two of the disciples are walking along and Jesus is talking and they don't know who it is, and Jesus acts as if he's going to go on, they have to say, no, come and stay. They have to invite him into the house, and that's when they recognize him. So I think there really is something to invitation here. They need to actually invite Jesus into the boat because he's not going to impose. And once they do, there is calm. The winds cease. And then we have that lovely image of Jesus being in the boat with them, it says. I think for all of us, that can be the reminder that Jesus is in the boat with us. Spirit is in the boat with us. And I believe Spirit is actually around us all the time. But perhaps sometimes when we actually ask and invite, it makes us more receptive. It actually awakens us so that when Spirit comes, we can really receive Spirit and connect with Spirit's presence. And that's the thing that brings the calm. That leads us back to the quiet center, to Psalm 23, to the restful waters. Because God wants our souls to be restored. And that's what Jesus models for us as well. So invite us just to take a moment and to drink that all in. Just to drink in the noticings of the passage. And then I'm going to invite you to notice what you notice, to notice what Spirit is saying to you directly in the passage as well. So I'll just take a moment and let us once again center ourselves in Spirit. And just take a moment to once again, connect with your soul and your heart. And I'm going to read the passage again. And I invite you to listen not with your mind, but with your soul and your heart. And just notice what shimmers for your soul. What is your soul drawn to? To notice what God might be saying directly to each one of us as we receive this passage. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. Jesus said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while." for many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went on shore, Jesus saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. After teaching the crowds and feeding the 5,000, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After saying farewell to them, he went up on the mountain to pray. When evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and Jesus was alone on the land. When he saw that the disciples were straining at the oars against an adverse wind, he came towards them early in the morning, walking on the sea. He intended to pass them by. But when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost and cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Then he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased. So I invite us just to take a few moments in silence to just notice and stay with what shimmers for your soul, what images or feelings may come with that, and is there any invitation for you from God and Spirit in the passage? We'll just take a few moments in silence. So I invite us, if there's anything you're noticing, feel free to share. And if you are off camera and want to share, feel free to raise a virtual hand and we'll acknowledge you there as well. What are you noticing as you read and hear the passage? Yes, Cindy.
Yes, I'm finding this a very beautiful passages and beautiful song. And it's filling me with a nameless peace. That just can be felt, doesn't have to be understood, doesn't have to be put into words. And I was wondering about the experience for Jesus. That there's a huge crowd. There's a smaller group in the boat. And then there's him on his own. And I was thinking, there's him walking up into the mountain on his own, a single person. And I was wondering if that was lonely. And then it flooded me, because this is something I've been struggling with this week. I went on my own for a trip to Indian Springs. And I'm on my own in the world, sort of thing. And then I was flooded with a, no, he's not lonely. He's not lonely. He's praying. And when you pray, you're not lonely. And I was thinking how he was, rather than having him in mind as exhausted and lonely, I was flooded with a knowing of him being full and at peace. And that was important as a thought, that he was able to look after himself and find what he needed. That's what he was doing, going up in the mountain. So that was just my experience.
That's beautiful, Cindy, and it's a beautiful noticing, and I love that comment that when we're praying, we're not alone. And maybe it's that we're actually never really alone. It's just that when we're praying, we notice that spirit is with us, or we feel the connection to spirit even more deeply. So that's a powerful noticing. And even speaking of the peace that can't be named, is powerful. And that Jesus himself perhaps was full of that kind of peace as he connected with spirit, and then he could share that peace with the disciples when they were afraid. And so that when we fill up, perhaps we might be an influence on somebody else and help create peace for them, because we have first received that peace from God. That's a beautiful, powerful noticing. Thank you. Others. Galia, I see your hand up. I'm so glad you're with us this morning.
Oh, thank you, Kimberly. Wonderful to be here. Well, that's, of course, a familiar story. We all have heard it so many times. I've never heard it that way before. It was unusual. It really kind of went deep, and I don't know how to explain it exactly, except that I really got Jesus' compassion and all he was willing to sacrifice for, you know, for human beings and his friends on the boat. I got too that Jesus is, you know, always there with us, whether or not we see him or recognize him, and that God is ever present, spirit is ever present. I'm finding it hard to put into words, but I was moved by the story in a way that I never have been. And I thank you for that. It felt real to me. It felt, it just went deeper. So thank you.
Thank you, Galia. It's always a pleasure to have you in our midst and part of our community. And
thank you.
And that's true. Sometimes that's the beauty of these sacred texts. Sometimes even if we've heard them 100 times, spirit, it's like they're living texts, right? So spirit can still work with them and deepen them. And it's almost like a bottomless well of reservoir. And that's what's so beautiful about these sacred texts. So thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yes, Ruth.
The phrase that stayed with me was the very last phrase, and the wind ceased. And I just thought about how often my life can feel like there's just all this wind constantly blowing. And I'm trying to keep my balance, which is part of the challenge that I'm dealing with right now medically. And the thing that struck me about the text as a whole was that the kind of like the flow of life, there are times we need to be alone to pray. There are times when we need to be with others in the boat, with other like-minded people, and times when we need to be of service to all the people that are needing what we have to give. And that there's this flow in life, and it doesn't have to be windy. It can just flow. So that's really what struck me is accepting that flow in my life. And with that flow comes a lot of unknowing. There's a lot of unknowing to do with the pandemic and where we are right now. There's a lot of other kinds of, there's lots of unknowing. And to be able to experience the calm in spite of the storm.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Experiencing the calm in spite of the storm. So that if our souls are centered, it doesn't matter what's going on around us necessarily. Yeah, that's beautiful. And we can trust, lean into the mystery and the unknown, because we know we are held in that. Yeah, that's a beautiful noticing. And just the noticing that the wind ceased, there are places of calm. Yeah, that's powerful. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yes, Hope.
What everyone shared ahead of me is kind of a similar experience I had. Everybody touched on a little bit of what resonated for me. But I think the thing that it really stuck out the most for me is, again, when we think we're like doing, we're the disciples were out there and taking care of or doing their best to handle the crowds. And, you know, that was what they were should do and expected to do. And when Jesus saw that, you know, maybe they weren't even at their best when they were so tired and they couldn't eat and they weren't, you know, they were there going through the motions, but maybe they couldn't even give what they really needed to give until they had taken care of themselves and put them in a space where their message could be shared in a different way and, you know, take care of yourselves. And so, you know, he said, come on, let's get away from there, go to the deserted island, you know, eat, rest, and really had compassion for them and had to remind them that that's what they need to do. And that is so often applies to me in my life. I'm just so busy with everything I'm doing and, you know, think, oh, that's what I got to do. And I'm probably not even doing it that well because I'm, you know, ragged on the edge of not having enough sleep or, you know, too distracted or whatever. And if I can take care of myself and return to that calm where I can be my best self, mm-hmm. then I can be much more effective. And that's what came through for me. Mm-hmm. But all the other things that were shared by all of you, you know, were there as well. So it's a good reminder. And it to have it followed by the Lord is my pace setter, that it was like it was written exactly for me. You know, I mean, they are, it's nice to have them back to back like that, because they are really the same message. Mm. It's beautiful. Thank you. Mm. It's my biggest struggle. I was trying to find a balance, and the reminders are here and said poetically and beautifully in both things that were shared today. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Hope. It's such a good point that I do think often too, as Christians, as spiritual people, we assume God always wants us to be working busy because that's the thing, right? But here the disciples are doing God's work. And Jesus still says, cease and desist, right? And so it's like a rewiring of our brains, I think, especially in this culture and in our American culture, which is always kind of work first, that Jesus modeled this and he instructed his disciples. And the other thing that I was noticing in the silence is that they didn't wait until everything was finished to rest. Like, there was still more work to do. There were still more people to tend to. And Jesus said, no, time out. Then you can go back to work. So yeah, what you're saying about productivity, it's one of the things I love about the passage we're going to look at next week, you know, just the vine and the branches. It's a whole different kind of productivity. Is it a productivity of juicy fruit and love and peace or not? So thank you for lifting that up, because you're right. I think Jesus, there's a different kind of fruit when we're able to follow Jesus's model, which isn't always easy for any of us to do. So yeah, lovely. Thank you. And well, if you wanted to share anything, Gabe, even though you're behind the scenes, you're more than welcome to.
I just wanted to say hi, Gabe.
Yeah, where he's obviously part of our community.
Hello, hello.
Hello. Was there anything you wanted to share, Gabe?
It's all right.
And it's okay if you don't.
Yeah. I guess I don't really have much.
Okay, that's all right. Well, I'll invite us then to receive this song, and I'm sure you've heard it before. It's Bobby McFerrin's version of Psalm 23, and it's just the same thing we've been talking about. It's like the peace that comes through the frequency of sound. And he, of course, as you may know, created this rendition for his mother, and so he intentionally put it in the feminine on behalf of his mother. So I invite us just to receive this, let it kind of wash over us as a musical version of just what we've been talking about. So let's receive this video and audio.
The Lord is my shepherd, I have all I need. She makes me lie down in green meadows, beside the still waters she will lead. She restores my soul, she rights my wrongs, she leads me in a path of good things, and fills my heart with songs. Even though I walk through a dark and dreary land, there is nothing that can shake me. She has said she won't forsake. sets a table before me in the presence of my foes. She anoints my head with oil and my cup overflows. Surely,
invite us just to take a deep breath and receive the frequency of spirit that comes through the depth of such beautiful music, such spiritual sound. As we do, may our souls be restored. Invite us to just take a deep breath and receive. God's presence is with us in the boat. And may that calm carry us through the day. So I invite us to say together our closing prayer, and then we will sing the Alleluia. This is by Kathleen Schmidt. Transforming presence of Christ. In the midst of the desert, you create an oasis where trees shelter us from the blazing sun. You invite us to drink from your living waters, that leaving behind the places of loss or strife, we enter into the community whose promise is shalom. Creative One, alluring presence, you are the Christ presence in each of us. Amen. And let us sing our closing song. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Remain in peace and share that peace with the world. Amen. Well, so beautiful to be with all you beautiful beings. And is there anything that anybody wanted to